We all misbehave sometimes. Wanna change the world, indulge in some bad behavior.
Hello and welcome to the Bad Behavior Podcast, where we talk about our journey to becoming badass women. And as always, we celebrate women, activism, and positive change. I'm Rosalind, currently in Melbourne, Australia.
And I'm Nicola, coming to you from New York City.
NYC!
And this week we're going to talk about homelessness and specifically homeless women. Yep. And the advocacy that word was a handful for me. All the amazing activists that are involved in raising awareness about the huge problem that is homelessness. I'm having some issues with words. So. It's all good. Let's power through. This week is a very exciting topic.
Big topic. So we are specifically talking about homeless women because homelessness is not a problem we're going to solve in this short episode. But before...
Rosalind, it's been quite a while since I've checked in with you about your bad behavior. So I'd like to ask you the sneaky cheeky question of... How have you been bad?
Okay. Yet again, I have a little anecdote about something that made me mad. Last time wasn't. Okay, I feel better now. So I was out with friends recently, as I try to be every now and again.
You're a social creature. Yes.
And, you know, we're joking around. I find, okay, bit of context. Australia has one of those cultures where it's like, you know, take a joke. We joke about everything. We're very irreverent, but it does mean that people joke about very serious issues. And if you take personal offense to it, people kind of say, oh, come on, it's a joke. Go along with it, which is not something I found when I visited you in America. It wasn't quite the same. Back to the story. I was out with friends and someone made a joke about that reference. It wasn't a joke about, but it did reference domestic violence. And for a second I was kind of like, oh yeah, it's fine. But then I went, hang on, Rosalind, what are you doing? And I said, hang on, let's pause for a second, guys. Can we count the number of women in this room? And there were a few. And I said, okay, so 1 in 5 women in Australia experience domestic violence. That's the data I have. It could be more. You just made a joke about something that someone in this room has experienced. Is that okay? Are we okay with that? And people kind of went, oh, come on. You know, this is full on. It's just a joke. He's just kidding. I don't accept that anymore. I don't want to be, you know, it's ingrained in me. I don't want to be the killjoy. I don't want to be the guy who says, hey, hang on, guys, pause. But you know what? From now on, I'm going to be. I'm sick of those kind of jokes. They're propagating this...
A culture, a really horrible, potentially dangerous culture.
Dangerous to women and also dangerous to men because it's teaching them that it's okay to act in a certain way. And it's not.
Absolutely. No, that's amazing. And it's really hard. You have to commend yourself for being able to do that because I know personally calling people out in large group settings, especially with your friends, is really difficult because it's what you said. You don't want to be the one who's taking stuff a bit too seriously or like, the feminist killjoy. It's all these labels that come with, you know.
Here she is on her soapbox again, getting all angry about the world. I say, fuck you, I'm doing it.
Calling out people's bullshit and stepping back and being like,
I can take a joke. I'm very funny.
You are a hilarious woman. Yes. Comedic genius.
Well, let's not go too far. We don't want to set expectations for this show that are too high.
But it's completely amazing to be able to do that and to teach. Because you have to teach yourself to do it.
I feel like next time I will find it a bit easier now that I've made this decision.
You've taken the first step.
All right, Nikki. Nicola, my darling.
Yes, my dear.
How have you been bad this week?
Well, mine is kind of the same vein as yours. It's been something that I've thought about for a while. It's about periods. That old...
you always say that old nugget.
That old nugget?
Is that a well-known phrase in America it's just that you've brought back?
I don't think it is. I think it's something that's just been at the front of my mind, like, for the past couple of months.
You need a new phrase.
That old chestnut? That old hazelnut?
Yeah, that old pecan. There are lots of
clearly
nuts
in the world. I am feeling like I want some nuts right now. That old almond. Love a good peanut. But anyway, back to the point at hand. When you talk about periods, people get really uncomfortable. That's just a general thing that I'm sure everyone has noticed, even if it's with close friends. people get really weird about it because it's
or
not,
it's a bit naughty to bring
yeah
it.
It's like you talk about those types of things in a hushed voice and you whisper certain words. It's like you say, do you have your period, or you're using all these code names. I was sitting at a table with a group of these two girls that I used to nanny for a long time ago. My anecdote last week was about another child whose life I influenced.
You
but...
are just changing small people's lives.
Oh, what could I say? But we were at dinner and one of the girls was, she was speaking quite freely about it and it came up as a topic. And they're both 14. They know very well what a period is and everything you need to know by that age about yeah it. And as soon as she said the word, the whole table went absolutely hushed. Like it oh, was awkward. So quiet and everyone was like, shit, she shouldn't have said that. And so same kind of thing that you did. I cut through that and it was probably a bit inappropriate because it was definitely like a formal dinner setting, but I was just like to her, I said, it's okay to talk about your period. You should never be ashamed to talk about it. And it is a natural thing that happens and something that is an amazing thing that happens to women.
This is another thing though, the idea that you said before where it wasn't appropriate to say it. Maybe we should get rid of the idea that there are appropriate times to say, hey, it's fine to talk about your period.
No, that is true. See, it's so ingrained in how you think though, and it's for a lot of things too.
I think I would struggle with it. I think this is definitely something that I do myself.
Well, once you've been taught to talk about things a certain way, to use a certain language associated with a topic, it's really hard to break it.
Nicola, I challenge you to keep this going.
I feel the start of a revolution coming.
Wave around that little, you know,
tampon,
whatever you use
above my head, yeah.
Maybe not if it's like a menstrual cup, but like wave it around, say, everyone,
I am no longer going to, if someone asks me what's up when I have a glum look on my face because I'm experiencing the worst fucking pains in my stomach and bleeding out of my fucking vagina, I am no longer going to say I'm fine. I'm going to be like, I've got my period, motherfucker. Yeah. Like,
I'm not a happy chap. I've just eaten my weight in chocolate and realized that I don't want to do anything or see anyone for the next
exactly year. I want to be in my bed for an eternity. But you know what, sir? I am not fine. I have my period.
Yeah, actually, interestingly enough, this links into the woman
that I
chose.
Oh, it absolutely does. Yes.
Yeah. So this week we are talking about homelessness. We're talking about female homelessness. There is the statistics for homelessness are just insane. So I think it was over 500,000 people in America every night will experience homelessness. So
it's horrible.
1 in 200 people in Australia are homeless on every given night. There are a lot of homeless people. It is a huge problem. And there are so many different people that are advocates for changing it. There are a lot of different plans in place, but we're still not progressive enough with our policies. I do believe that. And looking into it a little bit this week, there are so many levels to this problem. There's not an easy fix. So we're talking about a very specific part. We're talking about female homelessness. So your anecdote actually ties in really well with the woman that I chose. Her name is Dana Marlowe. I'm assuming that's how you say her name. Can't possibly be Dana. Maybe it is. Dana is where we're going.
Sounds good.
Okay. So she is a business owner. She's a mother. She's a human rights advocate. Oh my God, we've both had trouble with that word. Advocate. She's part of accessibility partners that help hiring people with disabilities and make technology like websites and mobile apps more accessible and usable for people with disabilities. So she's done a few things. But the thing that I want to talk about is her charity, Support the Girls. This is the story. In 2015, she went through a period of healthy living where she sort of changed a lot of her lifestyle. She decided she wanted to be healthier in her own body. I don't think it was about losing weight. I think it was just about being healthy. But through that, she did lose a lot of weight and her bra size decreased.
Yeah.
So she needed new bras. She went to get fitted and she asked the woman as she was doing it, is there anywhere I can donate my old bras? I have so many. And the sales assistant said, homeless women are in desperate need of bras. They wear the same one for like 2 years or lots of health problems with, you know, if you have larger breasts and you don't have proper support, all of that. Then later she saw an article about how lots of homeless women have to decide between a meal and buying tampons because it's not something that's given to them. It's such an important necessity.
Yeah.
So she decided to ask her friends and their friends if they could send used bras and new sealed packages of tampons and maxi pads to her.
Mm-hmm.
And it just, it got bigger and bigger. It went crazy. She had people, collections coming from all over the place, all across America, even overseas. Places like France was sending it. They had breast cancer survivors who had had double mastectomies and sent their old bras. They had people who got packages from men whose wives had passed away and wanted to donate their clothes to a good cause. Women who'd lost mothers, daughters, so on. They had an amazing community of people who just kind of rose to the occasion to donate their bras. And women who would send in tampons, and if they bought an extra one or there was a deal, they'd send them in. Yeah, a woman shouldn't have to choose between feeding herself and her personal hygiene and health. That's insane.
Absolutely not.
So basically, Support the Girls sends these packages across North America, and they also have four other locations worldwide. There is a Support the Girls Australia. Their mission is to restore dignity and self-respect to thousands of women. And in the last 12 months, 135,000 bras and 785,000 menstrual hygiene products have been collected and distributed.
That is fucking incredible.
Absolutely incredible. So it's definitely something that, weirdly, I never thought about. Obviously, I'm aware of the homelessness problem. I'm sure you are, Nicola, because it's something you do notice when you go to New York City.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's just, I can't believe I never thought about the fact that many women menstruate and many women are homeless. Combine the two, it's not a good time.
It is such an interesting topic. I mean, it comes from a place of immense privilege that we both have never even had to consider that. But it's just so insane that that would have to be like a daily thought that you would have, especially when you're on the streets and you have your period. It's not something that is, you know, interchangeable.
No.
It's not something that you can just kind of forget about.
Yeah. Oh, I just won't have mine today.
Yeah,
it's
just
not
won't
a choice.
Have no, no.
It's going to happen.
Oh, that's
it's
so
amazing.
It's also
interesting that on the Support the Girls website, where I was finding a lot of the information, there was a comments page. Maybe it was on one of the articles. Anyway, there was a comments page where some men had written in and saying that, why do we have to gender everything? Why does this charity only cater to women? There are more homeless men than women. Why do we have to gender everything? We are not saying that there aren't men who are homeless. There are enormous amount of
yes,
men who are homeless. But
absolutely,
this is a very specific issue. I don't think that there is a similar equivalent with men in terms of...
No.
There are lots of charities as well that give hygiene products, razors, and things like that
absolutely,
to men
yes,
and women. But I don't know, something about the idea of having your period on the street just hit me.
What a fucking amazing name to Support the Girls.
I know, because
I love that. Yeah, the girls.
I love a good pun.
That is such a good name and
so,
such a beautiful
organization. So Dana Marlowe, she does a lot of speaking at events and she's done a lot of media coverage and everything. She is pretty cool. There are heaps of other charities that do similar things, but this seems to be quite a large effort.
Wow. And to start from that, you know, tiny call to action just to her friends and family and to have
it grow.
Which
is something we can all do.
Yeah.
I have bras I haven't worn for years.
I know.
Sitting in the back of my drawer.
It's something that you tend to keep, you know? It's like...
Which is weird, because why?
Yeah, you don't...
It's not something you think of giving to charity.
I know that when I think about giving them to, like... Because I donate a lot of my clothes, but I always... With bras, there's something... Like, I've just been told or taught not to, like, to just throw them away, more so. Just because it's, like, an intimate product, so it's... excuse me, it's something that someone can't get a second life out of, which is completely untrue because things change, boobies change, and bras are fucking integral to a woman's
also
life.
Also, don't, if you are hearing this and you're thinking, hey, I've got a heap of bras I can donate, don't worry about your size, shape, form, whatever.
Absolutely.
They are looking for every color, type, anything. Sexy bras, supportive bras, bras for people with huge boobs, little boobs, doesn't matter. You know, if you just do a quick Google search, you will probably find people who are doing something like this, or I'll put the details of Support the Girls up on our website.
Great.
So who have you got today?
I have got an amazing activist. She's around our age, actually.
Really?
And her name is Danielle Carter.
Oh, two D's today.
Yes, Dana and Daniela. Beautiful names. She's incredibly strong and she had such a difficult life and has thrived in spite of everything that has happened to her. She grew up in the foster care system from when she was 18 months old and At 14, she finally decided to leave because she was facing a lot of trauma, physical, emotional, sexual abuse from the people who were supposed to be keeping her safe, which is horrible, especially as a 14-year-old having to make that decision to leave. And another key factor in her deciding to leave her foster family was she came out as transgender at 14 and she had really conservative Christian parents and they completely cut her off. So she was left by herself. And from that moment, she, for the next several years, she lived in the New York City subways. So this is a 14-year-old.
She was homeless at 14.
At 14, just coming out as transgender, just coming to terms with her gender identity. Fuck. And these people who are entrusted to care for her completely just backed away and said, we want nothing to do with you, which is just...
So she'd run out of options.
Yeah, it was horrible. So she survived during that time by engaging in survival sex so she could have a place to stay and some pocket money. She's quoted as saying it was a lifestyle of survival. While she was doing this, though, this is already a testament to how incredibly strong she was. She attended high school. The whole entire time was homeless in the New York City subways. I have a quote from her saying that, I realized the only way I'd be able to redefine my life, my role as either a victim or a survivor, would be to get an education. Which is so profound. That's a 14-year-old saying that. When I was researching her, I was just constantly astounded at how mature and just productive she has been her entire life about what she needs to do. So she underwent gender transition as a freshman. She was at a prestigious prep school at the time. And
what is a freshman?
Freshman is first year of high school.
Okay.
So grade 10, I think. No, because it's freshman, sophomore, senior. Well.
Okay.
So yeah, 10, 11, 12, grade 10.
Okay. So sorry, Americans. I have Okay.
It's all
it.
Good. Yeah, she was at this prestigious prep school and she was transitioning and she was also secretly homeless and none of
What a secret to have.
Yeah, none of the people in her community knew either. They knew that she was struggling and so
was it not something that she felt she could tell them or because of the stigma or
I think probably to do with that. She doesn't really comment on it. It's just not something that people knew. After completing high school, she blows up. She does amazing things. She's founded a global advocacy group called Gender Global. She appears in a Laverne Cox produced documentary, which is a really cool documentary called The T Word. Her presence in that movie opened up a lot of doors for her. And
so it's about being trans. And,
yeah. I have a quote from her saying that, I realized I had a powerful story and that I was either going to take this pain and trauma and turn it into freedom and success, or I was going to end up committing suicide. I just asked, are you going to allow all these organizations to work for you? No, the only person who can change my life is me.
Oh god. How? I just got chills.
It's incredible.
14 on the streets as a woman.
She's done so much amazing stuff. So she's also the national ambassador for the human rights campaign. She's done some incredible TED talks that I would really recommend. They're very, very interesting to listen to. And she was in 2015 recognized on the Trans 100 list. It just goes on and on with the amazing things that she's achieved with how young she is. And I read a lot of articles about her and a lot of interviews that she's done, a lot that she's written about being a homeless youth, especially one who is trans, and how difficult that can be. And one thing that struck me was she's quoted as saying, even though this may sound like an it gets better story, we cannot forget that we have a long way to go. We are in a state of emergency in the transgender community. You don't have to be transgender to take in this message. Our human experience, our collective human stories, are the catalyst to creating change in the world. Isn't that so beautifully put?
That is yeah, an incredible statement to make. I mean, neither of us are trans, and so I suppose there are a lot of parts of the issues that she faced that we wouldn't understand.
Absolutely, yeah.
I think that reading her story and hearing about it is very powerful.
The thing that drew me to her was she's so open about everything that she had to go through to get to where she is.
Yeah.
She recognizes her beginnings and she is so dedicated to changing the life to which she was born. A woman in charge of her own circumstances in the face of such adversity. It is one of those incredible stories where you're like, fuck. Are you serious? The world has chucked this much shit at you and you still manage to come up out of the water and be like, I'm here.
Hey.
I am the best damn thing this world has ever seen. Yeah, she was super cool and she has an Instagram which you can follow, which we'll put on our website. Yeah, she's just such a babe. I think she's so amazing.
What an incredible woman. Yeah, definitely something that we will talk about in a later episode. We do want to talk about the issues trans women face.
Absolutely.
But it's not something that we can talk about on our own, not being trans ourselves.
She's built a really accessible bridge for a conversation about LGBTQA plus the homelessness problem in that community, because it's huge. You can't even begin to comprehend how much people who identify as being, you know, outside of the heteronormative ideals.
I have friends who were kicked out of home when they came out to their parents.
Yeah, it's a well-worn story.
It's an old story, and unfortunately it continues to happen.
Exactly. So I felt like she was one of the first people who I've felt like I can, after reading her story, being so far detached from everything that's gone on in her life, that I can still make a difference. Does that make sense?
I think it does. It's so important that women like her share her story so that we can...
Yeah, I mean, it's the same as your woman too. It's like, it starts with a thought.
Well, with Dana Marlowe, I just realized it is something that I've gone through. She wasn't homeless herself, but just the idea that women weren't receiving female hygiene products, you know, it was kind of an issue I'd never thought about, which is absolutely insane to me that I'd never thought about it. And the fact that I don't donate my bras is insane now that I think about it. You know, her sharing her story, obviously not as turgid and horrible as some of the things that Danielle experienced, it's so important to talk about it. It's just so important.
Inspiring.
It is.
Yeah.
Goodness me, I'm going to be looking her up.
Yeah, you know, you definitely should. I feel like I find myself at this same point every episode where I'm like,
God damn it. I'm about to go into my drawers and get all my bras out.
I'm about to go and graffiti a wall outside and just goodness a big me. Bra. That's what I'm going to draw, a big ass bra.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. It could get you in trouble, but at the same time, I believe in your passion.
Oh, thank you so much. Maybe not productive passion. I don't know how, the means to an end with my artistic project, but you know what?
Maybe it just draw a picture of a bra.
Let's brainstorm.
Start small.
Let's brainstorm my activism. Maybe we could channel it somewhere else instead of graffiti.
Maybe. Maybe just tell your friends and family send tampons and maxi pads to charities like Support the Girls.
And on that note, thank you guys so much for listening. All the information that we spoke about in this episode will be on our website,
badbehaviorpodcast.com.
Exactly.
Thank you so much for listening. Check out our website for all the information and then subscribe to our show.
Woo! Yay. Yes, please. We would love to hear from you. If you have anything that you want us to discuss, if we fucked up in any way,
if you have stories about your bite arsery, we still want to hear them. And we will be back next week with more anecdotes and some more kick-ass women.